Good day, everyone. My name is Joanne Ranola, one of the researchers at the National Renewable Energy Laboratory. This presentation is entitled Overview of Common Load Modeling and Forecasting Approaches. As we go into this report, we will discuss the technical details of different approaches. The flow of today's presentation will start with a brief comparison between load modeling and load forecasting. This will be followed by presentations on load modeling approaches and load forecasting approaches. We will cite some examples and discuss the potential advantages and disadvantages. We understand that long-term load modeling and forecasting faces increasing level of uncertainties as we approach a future energy system. So we will end this presentation by imparting some key takeaways, such as the potential direction of new load modeling approaches. Load modeling and load forecasting differ in terms of scope, but they are related in the planning process. Load modeling covers two major steps: development of a model to estimate the load, and calibration of the load model. On the other hand, load forecasting involves the projection of the calibrated load model. Both are significant in addressing the load uncertainties in the future. The next slides will present overview of load modeling approaches. This figure illustrates various aspects of grid operations and planning that require strategies and decisions at different timescales. These range from operations of high-frequency switching devices in milliseconds to real-time operations in hours to generation and transmission planning in years. An overview of various load modeling approaches is presented in this figure. As earlier mentioned, load modeling involves two major steps: load model and calibration. Under step one, load model has two types, namely static and dynamic. A static load model represents power at the current instant in time, while a dynamic load model expresses power as a function of time. Under step two, calibration has three categories, namely statistical, Kalman, and heuristic. For today's presentation, we will focus on long-term load modeling approaches. For long-term planning horizon, load model is represented by a dynamic model, a composite load model, while calibration has two approaches, measurement-based and component-based. The following figures illustrate a composite load model. The left figure is an example of a composite load model used in the WECC, or Western Electricity Coordinating Council in the US. The advantage of this model is that it captures both static and dynamic loads, or motors. The right figures are examples of hourly load profile of static and dynamic loads in one day. The flowchart on the right describes a measurement-based load modeling approach. Starting from step one, data is collected at representative substations and feeders. That is why this approach is referred to as a top-down methodology. This is also sometimes called a behavior-based approach because the recorded static and dynamic responses of the loads are used to derive the load model. The International Council on Large Electric Systems identified several potential advantages and disadvantages of the measurement-based load modeling approach. The good news is this approach is simpler than the component-based approach. This is because the dynamic response of the load is directly recorded from the actual system. However, this approach has some limitations. One of them is the risk of divergence in identifying the optimal parameters of a composite load model or complex load model. Component-based load modeling approach is a bottom-up modeling methodology where the aggregated load model is derived from the classes, components, and characteristics of each load as shown on the right figure. Similar to measurement-based approach, the International Council on Large Electric Systems identified the potential advantages and disadvantages of the component-based load modeling approach. The good news is the component-based load modeling approach is applicable to component load models. It is also applicable to different systems and conditions, and it has capability to identify flexible or demand manageable components of the load. One of the disadvantages of this approach is it requires large-scale load surveys to gather data with sufficient quantity and quality. The next slides will present an overview of load forecasting approaches. We can categorize the approaches in load forecasting into five. range from the most straightforward to the most complex. They are time series, econometric, end-use, soft computing, and hybrid approaches. Time series approach is expressed as a function of time. The trend can be linear, polynomial, or logarithmic. On the other hand, econometric approach attempts to quantify the relationship between the demand variable and other explanatory variables. These include economic activity, weather, electricity price, natural gas price, and fuel oil price. End-use approach allows modeling of individual processes and technologies involved in the conversion and use of electricity. On the other hand, soft-computing approach parallels the ability of the human mind to reason and learn in an environment of uncertainty and imprecision. Lastly, hybrid approach combines two or more approaches in load forecasting. This table compares the five load forecasting approaches by presenting some of their potential advantages and disadvantages. Time series approach is the simplest approach, but it has curve-fitting issues when there is insufficient data or too much variability. Some historical patterns may also be not applicable in the future. Econometric approach captures the important drivers of load, but it requires accurate forecasts of variables to be used in the model. It can produce a poor forecast due to selection of wrong variables, wrong variable correlations, etc. End-use approach allows the composition of energy usage by component and inclusion of new component. The disadvantage of this approach is it requires plenty of data from each of the components of the load. Soft computing approach is one of the latest developments in load forecasting. It has a feature of continuous learning. It can handle large number of parameters as well as missing and noisy data. In contrast, it has a black box issue if not properly modeled. It has issue of overfitting if there is not sufficient data. Lastly, hybrid approach enables the planners to think out of the box. It gives options to select which combinations of approaches best fit to the planning requirements and objectives. The disadvantage of this approach is it may be expensive and require more time to develop and test. The next slides will present some studies available in the literature and industry practices on long-term load forecasting approaches. The first example is the study done in Tunisia. This was conducted to evaluate the performance of selected time series and econometric techniques for long-term forecasting. These are Bax-Jenkins or ARIMA, which stands for Autoregressive Integrated Moving Average, NAR or Nonlinear Autoregressive Neuronal Network, MLR or Multiple Linear Regression, and NARX or Nonlinear Autoregressive Neuronal Network with Exogenous Variables. The flowcharts of time series approaches are shown on this slide, with ARIMA algorithm on the left and NAR architecture on the right. On this slide, the flowcharts of econometric approaches are shown, with MLR-based algorithm on the left and NARX architecture on the right. This figure shows the results from the Tunisian study. The electricity forecast across the four selected techniques were compared with the actual data in Tunisia from 1986 to 2010. In the charts, Bax-Jenkins technique indicates the poorest performance. In terms of speed and accuracy, the NARX technique indicates the best performance as shown in the table. The chart compares the MAPE, or the mean absolute percentage error, between NAR and NARX. At 30 years forecasting horizon, NARX has lower error than NAR using a 10-year historical data. This indicates the value of adding exogenous variables in the forecast. The second study is the economic approach applied in Brazil. The flowchart on the left shows the long-term demand methodology used in some Brazilian distribution utilities. The methodology has three components, namely demographic, macroeconomic, and microeconomic models. This is an example of the modeling results from the Brazilian econometric approach, showing a range of scenario forecasts. In the chart, the total residential consumption exceeds the 2000 level by 2007 across the four growth rate scenarios. The third study is the soft computing approach done in Taiwan. In 2012, a case study was conducted using the data in Taiwan to test the potential applications of collaborative intelligence in long-term forecasting. The proposed methodology involves formation of expert committee and expression or modification of experts' views as shown in the flowchart. The modeling results demonstrate improvement in performance compared with other tested approaches. The proposed methodology indicates the lowest error in terms of root mean square error and mean absolute error. The proposed methodology also indicates the lowest MAPE or mean absolute percentage error among all the tested approaches. The fourth example is the end-use approach applied in the US. They call it a statistically adjusted end-use or SAE, as the methodology incorporates statistical adjustments to improve load forecasting. The end-use framework shown in the chart below consists of loads from cooling, heating, and other equipment, both at residential and commercial levels. The last example is a hybrid approach used to forecast electricity sales and peak demand in Peninsular Malaysia. The methodology combines econometric and end-use approaches. The econometric approach is used to create a baseline forecast of sales, while the end-use approach builds a forecast for each customer segment. The two approaches are calibrated and combined to come up with the final forecast. This chart shows the multiple layers that comprise the load components in the end-use approach in Peninsular Malaysia. Examples of customer segments are office buildings, retail customers, and supermarkets. Each of the customer segment has different end-use requirements, such as lighting, cooling, and refrigeration. In the analysis, an improvement was observed by comparing the forecast of hybrid approach and older forecast. In the charts, hybrid approach is represented by econometric forecast, while older forecast is the SB forecast. In the results, the MAPE or mean absolute percentage error improved by 58% in commercial sector and 80% in industrial sector. This figure is an example of commercial end-use forecast that aligns with the econometric forecast used in Peninsular Malaysia. Let's move on to the last section, key takeaways. The first key takeaway is that the load forecasting methodologies have evolved over time in response to changing power sector. In 2018, a study done by the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory found out that most of the 12 Western U.S. electric utilities have evolved their load forecast methodologies over the past 15 years. This is with respect to analysis framework, techniques, and data sources. The second key takeaway is there's a need for better modeling, forecasting, and planning tools. The figure on the left illustrates the complexity of forecasting a long-term electricity load. It requires a range of future scenarios to capture the uncertainties in demographics, gross domestic product, technology, and generation. It also needs to consider changes in end-use profiles, evolution of prosumer or consumption and production of electricity, and spatial factors. As the complexity increases, there is a need for a better or more accurate tools. There is a need to improve modeling of considerable weather changes and extreme events. The improvements will allow grid operators to manage the power system in a more reliable and cost-effective manner. Lastly, we identified potential directions of new load forecasting approaches. In 2019, Lindbergh and others highlighted three directions. Number one, forecasting by sector, then disaggregating on hourly basis. Number two, aggregating the stochastic individual load profiles. And number three, linking short-term and long-term development trends. In 2016, Galekondabi and others recommended the development of simple methods with acceptable accuracy. And lastly, because long-term planning horizon faces so many uncertainties, there is an increased need to model a range of demand scenarios to capture normal and extreme conditions. These are some of the references used in this presentation. Thank you, and have a great day ahead.